Good evening. I just want to briefly introduce Ed, and then we'll let him get started. My name is Ananda, and I am the Vice President of Engineering Council. This event is in celebration of National Engineers Week, which is next week. So Ed has, he's a really interesting person. I first found out about him when I was 8 years old, and I watched an IMAX movie on Mount Everest. And ever since then, I was kind of enthralled by mountains and mountaineering, and that's definitely due to Ed's part in that movie. So Ed has climbed Mount Everest 7 times. He has also he's summited all 14 of the world's 8,000 meter peaks without supplemental oxygen, which is a pretty incredible feat. He's climbed Mount Rainier 208 times. And one of my personal goals, he's been on the Colbert Report. So let's give him a round of applause and thanks for coming out.
Thank you. Thank you. Thanks for coming. I actually showed this photo. In the Colbert Report, and he goes, that could be anybody, you know. Should we dim the lights a little bit, the house lights? Could we do that? Thanks to Ananda for having me in the College of Engineering. It's kind of cool. I grew up in Rockford, Illinois, where you know that's northern Illinois here. And can we dim the stage lights at all? And it's great to be back in the great mountaineering state of Illinois. I got kind of nervous though coming in today because it's so flat and that's why I left but to kind of help you today during the show, I thought we might refrigerate the room and suck the oxygen out as well. But and I can also say that, when I was in high school growing up, my number one goal for a career, I wanted to be a veterinarian. And I actually applied here to the University of Illinois, but instead of coming south, I took a hard right and went to Seattle. So I'm an almost alum, you could say. Almost came here. And instead, I went here to the mountains. Can we get a little dimmer, please, just so the slides show up a little better? So this is what I'm going to talk about, my career of climbing the highest mountains in the world, primarily the mountains over 26,000 feet, which is roughly 8,000 meters. And there's 14 of these 8,000 meter peaks in the world, and I spent the last 30 years or so climbing them. And a lot of people kind of wonder, for obvious reasons, why would you choose to do something that is relatively dangerous? You know, people die climbing mountains, they get cerebral edema, pulmonary edema, they get frostbite, and there's a lot of accidents that occur in the mountains. And through my reading and through what I learned and for what I did in the mountains, I discovered that a lot of the risks and a lot of the deaths and a lot of the accidents that do occur in the mountains are based on judgment. You know, people, their ambition overcomes common sense, and they're willing to die for the sake of climbing a mountain. For me, that didn't make sense, right? And I thought, for me, the art of mountaineering would be to manage the risk, to be well-prepared, well-trained, conservative, thoughtful, knowing when to turn around in the face of uncontrollable risk. And I thought that would be a way to make this a sustainable hobby. And so I've been doing this now for a long time, and it did start as a hobby, and I'm still very passionate about it. And through the years then, to kind of keep doing what I wanted to do, I had to turn it into a profession. And so when I go to work now, this is what I wear. This is my business suit, you might say. And it's a one-piece down-filled suit, a single layer of fabric called like Gore-Tex, breathable, waterproof fabric. But when you're on the top of a mountain like this, 28,000 feet, there's only a third the amount of oxygen that there is at sea level. It's 20 degrees below zero. And you can't live up there permanently. So we're transient visitors. You know, we spend 10 weeks getting to that point. We spend 15 minutes on the summit, and we get the heck out of there. Because of the lack of oxygen, we need to minimize the time that we spend at these altitudes. And because of my work now, this is my office. You know, this is the view from my office, and it's probably one of the best office views you can imagine, but it is a hell of a commute. So growing up in Rockford, you know, how does a kid, boom, decide that they want to go climbing mountains? I was reading adventure books. I read about polar exploration and the race to the South Pole. And fortunately, in the same part of the library, I bumped into this mountaineering section of books. And the one book that I read that really captivated me was titled Annapurna. And it was written in 1950 by the leader of the expedition, Maurice Herzog. It was a French expedition. And they went halfway around the world to Nepal to try to climb Annapurna, which was the 10th highest mountain in the world. And here you see Maurice Herzog on the summit of Annapurna. And when they went to climb Annapurna in 1950, none of the other 8,000 meter peaks, none of the 14 other mountains in the world over 26,000 feet had yet successfully been climbed. Although there have been multiple attempts on Everest and on K2 and other of the 8,000ers, none of them had been climbed. And all of the 14 8,000 meter peaks, they lie literally halfway around the world, either Pakistan, Nepal, or Tibet in the Himalayas, that 700 foot long range of mountains. And these guys in 1950 went with the goal of climbing Annapurna, and they succeeded. But it was a huge undertaking. They spent 2 months just trying to find the mountain because the maps were wrong. And at the last minute, within 2 weeks of the monsoon coming, Maurice, this great leader, pulled it together. They had great logistics, they had great teamwork, and in the end, two of that team got to the top. And that's the way expeditions operated in those days. Everybody went as a team, they worked for each other, they helped each other, and if one or two of those team members got to the top, that was a success. You know, it's very, very altruistic. Today, it's almost like it's every man for himself, but in those days, it was team-oriented. And I was really intrigued with that process and that endeavor, and I thought, that's something I'd like to do somewhere down the road. I like things that were physical, I like things that were mentally challenging, you know, those logistics. And for me, climbing these big mountains and going on an expedition was kind of this long-term goal, something that you could really, really sink your teeth into. And so I thought that that would fit my personality. And I knew, you know, it wouldn't happen overnight. I couldn't just get up off the couch and go to Annapurna. You know, it would take many, many years of training, of gaining experience, of meeting the right people to eventually go on one of these Himalayan expeditions. So I set my sights on hopefully eventually doing that. And there'd be a lot of steps I'd have to take along the way. And I knew that first ultimate step that I had to take would be to get myself out of Illinois. So right out of high school, I packed my bags and I moved to Seattle. And I've lived there ever since the late 70s. I got into the University of Washington. I went there for 4 years. Then I went to Washington State and went there for 4 years and got my degree in veterinary medicine. So that childhood dream did come true. But in the meantime, I focused a lot of my free time and attention on climbing the mountains of the Cascades. Right out of Seattle, an hour or two away, we've got this whole range of mountains. We've got Mount Rainier, 14,410 feet, an extremely glaciated mountain. And a lot of the great Himalayan climbers that came from the U.S. started in the Pacific Northwest, because Mount Rainier was this ultimate training ground. You know, it's steep, it's glaciated, the weather sucks. Whatever you learn by climbing on that mountain time and time again, you can take all those lessons and all that experience that you gained and take that with you to the bigger mountains of the world. So I went out there, I'd read a lot about climbing, I had not done a lot of climbing, and so I found people that were willing to take me with them into the mountains, to teach me. You know, I could rope up with them, I could belay them, and I learned by doing, I learned by listening, and I just learned by going out there day after day after day. And eventually I learned enough after 3 or 4 years of climbing that I got a summer job guiding on Mount Rainier. And I started working there in 1982. And since that date, I've been to the summit now of Mount Rainier 208 times. And most of those times, I was responsible for the clients that were paying me to help them to get to the summit. And I learned so many great lessons by being a guide. because it was all about being safe. It was all about being conservative. It was all about, you know, the round trip. Because we were in charge of taking these customers not just to the top, but to make sure they got home. So safety was the priority. We learned, in fact, as well, that being a team, we were stronger than climbing as individuals. And so we rope up together. Whenever you're on these glaciated terrains, you have to rope together to prevent each other from falling into a crevasse. I learned a lot about customer satisfaction as well, and customer service. In fact, I think we practice what I feel is the ultimate form of customer service. You know, we have to keep our customers alive. And so, and I think because of my training as a guide, that's why I'm standing here alive today, because I had this very, very conservative attitude when I went to climb these big mountains. So Mount Rainier was this great stepping stone for me. And as a guide, I eventually went to Mount McKinley, I went to South America, I went to New Zealand, and then I had dreams and aspirations that, you know, maybe someday, maybe I could go to try to climb Mount Everest, because I was kind of fixated with climbing to the highest altitude on Earth. And this is the highest peak on Earth, 29,035 feet high. And there's only a third the amount of oxygen on the summit as they're at sea level. So whenever I think about going to a mountain, you know, I kind of read about it, I research it, I try to see what went right, what went wrong, what's the history, just so that I'm kind of familiar with it when I actually get to try to go. And Everest has this amazing history. And you gotta imagine when people try to climb to the top of Everest, they knew there wasn't very much oxygen at the top. So even from the 20s, they started to develop these oxygen systems to help supplement what wasn't there. This is a photo of a climber from the 1920s. And you know, he's got something on, wearing, you know, tweed jacket and knickers. This is what you would wear to church today. And this is what they wear when they went to try to climb Mount Everest. They've got steel tanks of oxygen on their backs. He's basically got a regulator here coming from his oxygen system to this regulator, and then a hose that he's simply holding in his mouth. And when he needed a hit of oxygen, he'd turn the valve on, take a few breaths of oxygen, and then turn it off. And so very archaic, very heavy, you know, very primitive. Even in 1953, when Hillary and Norgay first reached the summit of Everest, they had oxygen. It wasn't until 1978 that Reinhold Messner and Peter Hagler climbed the summit without. So for a lot of the history of Everest, oxygen was the key. And even now, we have very simplistic, relatively primitive oxygen systems because there's not a market out there for anybody to really develop and sell oxygen systems just for Everest climbers. So quite typically, like this climber, this is an old Soviet fighter pilot mask, and that's kind of the typical use that we're using now on Everest. And as you can see, it's pretty messy, pretty complicated. You got goggles on, you got this mask, you got tubes and regulators. And this is kind of the system that's state of the art now. This is a bottle of oxygen. It weighs about 6 pounds, fully pressurized, and holds about 6 hours of oxygen at a 2 liter per minute flow rate. And a typical Everest climb from the high camp to the summit and back is about 18 hours. So most climbers use 3 bottles on a summit ascent from that highest camp. They might carry 1 or 2, and on a lot of the guided ascents, there'll be Sherpa that climb along to help carry the additional bottles. And it was quite normal as you emptied a bottle of oxygen on Everest. When it was empty, you would take it out and you would just leave it there. So you can imagine how many bottles of oxygen finally accumulated before we came along and cleaned it up. But still very simple. Here's a regulator that shows how much oxygen pressure is still left in the tank, a tube with a little flow gauge going into the mask, and in here is where the oxygen mixes with ambient air. So even though there's 100% oxygen in the tank, you're breathing a mixture of oxygen and ambient air as you're climbing. And when you're getting near the summit, you can see here's a climber just below the top. And you can barely see your feet with this, you know, giant pig snout of a mask in front of your face. And it is very complicated. It is kind of like a life support system. Most climbers, when they go to Everest from Camp 3, the second to highest camp, will start sleeping on oxygen, living on oxygen, climbing on oxygen. So they're becoming very dependent on this system. But it helps these climbers, you know, there's been 2,000 or so climbers that have climbed to the top of Everest. Without it, they wouldn't have made it, because they're stronger, they're faster, they think more clearly, they stay warmer. So without this benefit, most of the people that have climbed Everest would never get there. But for me, it was too complicated. There's too much stuff. You know, if something breaks, you could die. It's expensive as well. And I thought, for my own peace of mind, if I had the chance to go to Everest or one of these other mountains, I didn't want to use that contraption to help me get to the top. I wanted to climb the mountain for what it was. And so the decision for me was to not even use supplemental oxygen. And if it meant never getting to the top of Everest, then so be it. That was my rule. You know, I knew it would be harder. I'd have to train more. I'd have to focus harder. I'd have to suffer more. But in the end, I thought the rewards would be greater. And as I said, secondarily, I didn't have a lot of money, so I wouldn't have to go buy the oxygen. So it'd be cheaper as well. So about 10 years into my career as a guide, I was surrounded with a lot of senior guides that had already or were going to Everest and to other great peaks of the world, and they were organizing expeditions and they were funded by sponsors. And so I kind of kept my mouth shut and worked hard, and in 1987 I got invited to be a team member on one of these Everest expeditions. And what I've diagrammed here is what's called the normal route on Everest, or the easy way to the top. This is base camp here at 18,000 feet on the Nepal side. And it takes about 10 days of walking just to get to this base camp. And this is kind of where you live then for the next three months, basically. From here, you build up a series of four camps, with the last camp at about 26,000 feet. And then from there, it's a 3,000 foot climb to the top. But it takes 8 or 10 weeks or so just to carry all the gear to those various camps, the tents and the sleeping bags and the ropes and the food and the fuel and the oxygen. And then from there you springboard your way to the top. So all told, that entire climb could take 10 weeks. And this is where most people climb Everest. It's, yet again, the easiest way. But in 1987, we thought, you know, why go where everybody else is going? Let's draw our own red line and let's climb right up the north face. You know, it was more mysterious, it'd be more intriguing, there's no real guaranteed outcome of success, but let's go try something different. And so we did. And there's going to be about 8 of us on this expedition. We're now climbing on the Tibetan side of Everest. And from base camp, as I mentioned, we've now got to start carrying all this stuff up the mountain. There's nothing there when you arrive. So you've got to schlep it all into base camp, and then you start shoveling this gear up the hill. And in deep snow, I mean, we have to work together as a team. The first guy out front, he's kicking the steps in the snow, and he might do that for 15 or 20 minutes, literally to exhaustion. Then he'll swing aside, and then the next climber in line will kick steps for 15 or 20 minutes. It's just like, you know, the lead guy in the peloton of a bike race. The first guy in front is always doing the hardest work. So we're working together as a team. Individually as well, we've got to contribute. Not only are we carrying our own personal gear up the mountain, we have to carry group equipment as well. And our packs might weigh 40, 50, sometimes 60 pounds, because all this stuff needs to be carried up the mountain. So our contribution during this buildup is quite visible. You know, it's not like you can hide in the corner office and pretend to be contributing. Here it's all very visible and transparent. So we spend the next 10 weeks or so carrying all this equipment up the mountain to establish these camps. This might be Camp 1, for instance, at about 20,000 feet. You know, we set up the tents, and we start filling these tents with supplies, the sleeping bags and the food and the fuel and the oxygen, so we can occupy that camp. Then we all go back down, we grab more stuff, and then we start climbing to an even higher camp, So we're literally going up and down, higher and back down, higher and back down, higher and back down for 8, 9, sometimes 10 weeks. And you can imagine the amount of attrition that occurs, how hard that is. The higher you go, the harder it gets. And you lose 15 or 20 pounds just during that process. But it is a necessity as well, because it slowly allows us to acclimatize to the rarefied atmosphere. You know, we're building more red blood cells that let us operate at these higher altitudes. So eventually then, after like 8 or 10 weeks, we've then managed to build a pyramid of supplies up the mountain, and we established 4 camps along the way. And because of the altitude, because of how hard it is to work at these altitudes, it's all we can do to set up that final camp within striking distance of the summit. And as a team, one tiny little tent, just barely enough stuff in there for maybe 2 of the members of the expedition to climb up to that camp, to spend the night, and then from there, launch themselves to the top. And these tents at these altitudes, they get smaller, they get lighter, they're single layer. Anything that we can do to reduce weight up at these altitudes is what we try to do. So we've established all the camps, we're acclimatized, we all go down to base camp now, and we have a team meeting, and we say, okay, now who's the 2 guys that get to represent the team to then go to the summit? And during this meeting, believe it or not, nobody raises their hand. You know, everybody by then just wants to go home, because you've been there for so long, and you're homesick, and the food sucks, and you're tired, and all that motivation that you had at the beginning is gone. You know, it's like writing a term paper. You know, at the beginning, you're enthusiastic, you put a little time and energy, and by the last night, you don't really care anymore, right? You just want to hand it in and get it over with. I raised my hand, and based on my contribution, I was selected to go with the leader for that final push to the top. Pretty cool. So we spent the first 4 days climbing through those camps, spent the night, and on that 5th morning, we get up at midnight. We want to start at about 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning. We climb out of that little tent at 27,000 feet, turn on our headlamps, and we begin then, hopefully, that final 3,000 foot ascent to the summit. And that alone is going to take us about 12 hours just to get to the top. So that's the reason we start so early. If we're starting at 2 in the morning, we hope to be on the summit no later than 2 in the afternoon, so that we have enough time to get back down before it gets dark. And then the storms start to come in the afternoon as well. So we started climbing. Things went great. For about the first 10 hours or so, I'm climbing without oxygen. My partner's climbing with oxygen, but we managed to stay together. And I thought, wow, we're going to get to the summit. And we finally then found ourselves here, 300 vertical feet away from the summit. We're now at 28,700 feet. And we're looking at that last 300 feet. We could see the top. But then the weather started to get bad very, very quickly. The winds increased, started to snow. Visibility went to hell, and we're thinking, oh my gosh, are we going to be able to push our way to the top and survive the descent? We didn't know. So we stood here on the ridge, and we had a meeting. We had to discuss our options based on the risk. We figured with the storm getting worse and worse by the minute, we could still force our way to the top. We had 2 hours of climbing left, we assumed. At those altitudes, 300 feet takes 2 hours. We thought we could battle our way to the summit. We could plant the flag. We could succeed in our attempt, and that would be good. But secondarily, on the way down, we would die. And that would not be good. So we made what I thought was a very logical decision, and we stopped. That was the end of the climb, based on the risk. You know, it has to be a round trip. I've always said getting to the summit is optional, getting down is mandatory. So imagine making that decision. And what do you think a lot of other people, when they're faced with that decision, make? What do you think they do? They decide to push on to the top. You spend so much time and energy and money to get to that point, you don't want to quit. And that's why a lot of people die in the mountains, because of their ambition. They're not willing to listen to the mountain. And that's what I learned as a guide. You've got to listen to the mountain. And it decides, ultimately, what you're allowed to do and what you're not allowed to do. And if you can't get to the top, not for lack of trying, not for lack of motivation, not for lack of planning and logistics, if the mountain has decided, that's not a failure. It's simply a non-success. And I can live with that. I can walk away and say, you know what? The mountain shut me down. I can go home. I can regroup. If I got to come back again and again and again, I'll do so, because that mountain will always be there. So it's based on patience. You've got to just wait for that right opportunity to go back. And so we walked away. And I actually went back to Everest in 1988 and had a non-success again. So there's two strikes against me on Everest. So in 1989, I took a break from Everest, and I went to Kanchenjunga. This is the third highest peak in the world, 28,200 feet. A little bit different climbing than Everest. This is a 3,000-foot ice wall that we had to climb on our way to the summit. But we had a really strong team. We had really, really good conditions, and after about 8 weeks of effort, we got to the summit. And here I am with my two partners on the summit of Kanchenjunga, 28,200 feet. Here you can see one of the oxygen bottles that some other expedition, probably a year or two earlier, you know, they emptied the bottle and boom, left it there on the summit. So this was my first successful climb of an 8,000 meter peak. And we're hanging out here on a good day. We might be able to stay an hour if the weather allows. And you gotta remember, this is, you know, almost cruising altitude of most jet aircraft. So imagine if you're on a plane ride in a week or two, look out the window at cruising altitude and imagine a couple guys out there waving at you. It's kind of what we're doing. And this is the view that we get then from the summit of Kanchenjunga. And on a good day, this is part of the reward. And even though I was on the summit of Kanchenjunga, you know, I'm kind of one of these guys that if I don't finish something, it bothers me. There's Mount Everest. That was bothering me. You know, 80 miles away, I was like, I'd rather be on the summit of Mount Everest. And I desperately wanted to go back and finish, you know, that last 300 feet. And I didn't know if I'd ever have the chance, but I was hoping that I would. So when you get to the summit, you know, people say that's a success, that's when you phone home, that's when you party, but in fact, that's premature. Getting to the top is half the climb, and it's the least half of the least important half of the climb, in my opinion. Getting down is the second half of the climb. And this is where people, you know, they drop their guards emotionally and psychologically. They're kind of spent from going to the top. They've used all their oxygen in some cases. They've run out of daylight. They've used all of their resources to get to the top, and they've left nothing for going down. And it's on the descent where a lot of problems occur. Again, you've got to plan on going down, budget for going down before you even plan for going up. And it's not until you sit at the bottom of the mountain that you can say that was a successful climb. So finally I had an 8,000 meter peak under my belt. And the following year, in the spring of 1990, I was invited to go on my third expedition to Mount Everest. And we'd be climbing via the Tibetan side, we'd be climbing here via the North Ridge. And this is where Mallory and Irvine disappeared in the late 20s. Our high camp was right about here at 27,000 feet. And from there, just because of the way the cards played out, I found myself alone. This is about 8 weeks into the expedition, climbing that last 2,000 feet to the summit. So on this particular summit day, I didn't have a partner with me to help kick the steps in the snow. I didn't have somebody to help motivate me as I was gasping for air climbing toward the summit. So for those 12 hours from high camp to the top, I had to be self-motivated. And as you go higher at these altitudes, especially without supplemental oxygen, you go slower and slower and slower. And let's say at 28,000 feet, you might take a step and then stand there and breathe literally 15 times. You count the breaths. and then you take another step, and then you breathe 15 times, and you think about taking another step, and then you breathe 15 more times. And you do that, that's all you do for 12 hours. And about 8 or 9 or 10 hours into that day, that's all you've been doing. You start questioning, why am I here? Why do I like this? You know, your lungs are aching, you've got a headache, some people get nauseous, you got snot frozen on your face, and you kind of have to enjoy the moment and tell yourself, I am here because I want to be here. And you know, there's no pot of gold on the summit, there's no trophies, there's nothing up there. So you have to want to do it for your own personal satisfaction. And that's what drives people to the top. It's the people that, you know, when the hurting gets so bad, they decide, you know what, I don't like this, I want to turn around. And so a lot of people that go up there, they just quit because they don't want to suffer to go to the top. I was willing to suffer, and finally then on that day, found myself here on the summit of Mount Everest. Pretty cool moment. You know, having grown up in Illinois, and there I was standing on the highest point on earth. But when I got to the top, I was all alone. There's nobody there. You know, there's no news at 5, there's no ESPN cameramans to celebrate with. I was completely alone on the summit of Mount Everest. Pretty neat. But I thought, how am I gonna get a photo for the office wall? So I took my ice axe and I stuck it in the snow vertically and used it as a monopod, and I balanced my camera on top of that and set the timer, and that's how I got my own self-portrait from the top of Everest. And the view that you get is quite spectacular, and you're literally looking down on every other mountain on the planet. This is Makalu, the fifth highest peak in the world, 28,000 feet. There's Kanchenjunga, 80 miles away, 28,000 feet. I'm 1,000 feet higher than those mountains. And as I looked around, I said, Ed, memorize this view, because you'll never climb Everest again. You only climb Everest once. Maybe most rational, intelligent people only climb Everest once. You know, little did I know I would climb it 6 more times. I have a great excuse for the second time, though, because I left my wallet up there. I had to go back up. So I climbed Everest now, the highest, Kanchenjunga, the third highest. My next goal, I felt ready for an attempt on this mountain. This is K2. This is the second highest mountain in the world, 28,250 feet. Beautiful, beautiful peak, spectacular. One of the hardest mountains in the world to climb. As you can see, very steep on all faces. Many people attempt K2, and an almost equal number of people fail on K2. The weather is unpredictable, the climbing is relentless. But in 1992, I felt ready to make an attempt. And I joined forces with a friend of mine. This is Scott Fisher. We were both living in Seattle at the time, and we both wanted to go to K2, but we didn't have the money to organize our own expedition. Excuse me. But we got barely enough money together for just the two of us to go, and we then kind of bought our way onto a loosely formed expedition of people that kind of really didn't know each other. There wasn't really team unity, there wasn't great leadership, and it wasn't something that I was used to. I'd been used to going with friends and people that I trusted and I liked. But we thought, let's try to make this work. Let's try to pull this group of people together as a team. And we spent the next 8 weeks trying to climb this mountain. And as you can see, the terrain was on average 40 to 45 degrees from the bottom to the top. And K2 threw everything at us that it could. We had bad weather. We had windstorms. We had camps that were destroyed. We had avalanches. We had rescues that we were involved with. And slowly the team started to disintegrate, people started to give up, people started to go home. But Scott and I and a few others, we eventually persevered that we then climbed here to 26,000 feet. And this is then where we established our highest camp. From here, we then hoped to go to the top. And this is the tent that Scott and I are now gonna hopefully live in for only one night. And again, as you go climb higher in these mountains, the physical effort needed to carry anything increases. And so to make things lighter, you know, one of the great ways to make things lighter is you make them smaller. And so these single layer tents weigh only 5 pounds, but they're barely big enough for two people to climb into, barely big enough. And Scott was about 6'4", 230 pounds, and he always got in first. And then whatever room was left over in the corner, I kind of sat there. But again, it's only your shelter, hopefully for one night. From here, we're going to then climb that final 2,000 feet, hopefully, to the top. And as you can see, the higher you go on K2, the steeper it gets. We've got to climb halfway up. This is a big brow of kind of overhanging ice, which we're going to have to climb underneath for a couple of hours. And I nicknamed it the motivator, you know, because when you're underneath it, it motivates you to climb faster just to get out from under it. But as we sat there that night and kind of went to bed and laid there for a few hours and rested, we hoped that we would get up at midnight, climb out the tent, and start the climb. But the mountain had other ideas. And a storm came in, and because of that storm, we were then effectively trapped, Scott and I, in that tiny little tent for the next 3 days. So imagine sitting in that little tent, hopefully with somebody you like. We haven't carried a book up there. This was way before iPods, so we had no way to entertain ourselves. You don't have an appetite up there, so you don't waste time eating. I'd been with Scott for 3 months, so there's nothing left to talk about. So you just sit there and you wait and you wait and you wait. And it's extremely boring. And the only way I can have you guys figure out what that feels like is tonight, with a friend, climb into the closet and stay there for 3 days. Pretty much what it's like. So finally, though, the weather broke after 3 days of our suffer fest, and we were able then to climb out of that tent, and here we are climbing on our way to the summit. Here we're traversing underneath what I called the motivator. And it took us about 10 hours that day, and we then did finally climb here to the summit of K2. And this was a season where a lot of people simply gave up, and they went home because it was too hard. And you know what? We knew it was going to be hard. And I think that's how you succeed in these difficult endeavors. You just assume, you know what you're signing up for, and you deal with it. And I kind of have to say, it's kind of like mind over matter. If you don't mind, it doesn't matter. And it was an amazing experience, to climb and survive K2. But it's also one of those mountains where you climb it and you walk away. You don't ever bother coming back to that mountain. But it was an amazing experience. So then, after having climbed Everest, K2, and Kanchenjunga, you know, I had the three highest peaks in the world under my belt. And I thought, wow, why not instead of randomly climbing a mountain here, climbing there, why not make a concerted effort and have a plan? And I decided I wanted to go out and climb all 14 of the 8,000 meter peaks without oxygen. I figured I'd done three, there's only 11 left. And I didn't know how long it would take, 10 years, 15 years, 20 years. I thought this would be a cool journey, something I could really sink my teeth into. And so I called this Endeavor 8000. That was the name of my project. And I told everybody, here's what I'm going to do. Here's what I'm going to try to do. And I figured I had the skill and the desire and the motivation to do all these climbs. But the one key element that I didn't have was the money. How was I going to pay for all of these expensive expeditions? So I had to learn about marketing. I had to start calling and writing letters to all these companies and people that I kind of networked with to say, give me money so I can go climb mountains. But I had to figure out how to intrigue them. You know, they had to get something out of it, whether it was advertising, promotions, endorsements, equipment design, testing. And that's then how I slowly, over the years, cobbled together a portfolio of sponsors. You know, people whose products I used, developed, tested, you know, did advertising for, you know, and because of that, you know, I looked like Mario Andretti. I had all these logos and caps and flags, but that was then how I was able to pay the bills. And so it took a long time, and it was that was almost harder than climbing mountains. Trying to find the money to pay for these climbs was the hardest thing I had to do along the way. But finally, things started to click and I was able to make it work. So we get to the summit of the mountains, you know, and I typically would climb with a partner or two that was also, quote unquote, a professional. And people thought, oh, there you go, climbing the mountains, you're having a great time, you're on vacation. But in fact, we'd get to the top and we would actually, we're then going to work. You know, I've got to start flying the flags of all the people that were supporting me, you know. And I had more and more and more of these flags, and you know, my partner would take pictures of me and I'd take pictures of him. And we took the time to do this, because if we didn't, you know, give back to these companies for what they were giving us, you weren't nurturing that relationship, and it would be short term rather than long term. And I needed this money to allow me to go climbing. But along the way, you know, I've got 8 or 10 of these flags on every summit, and I'm willing to carry, I'm willing to take the photos. But along comes Photoshop, and I thought I could get away with one flag, and then when you come home, I would just implant whatever logo on my computer and put it right there on the flag. So in short, this is then how I was able to support myself, and this is how I became a paid professional climber. So armed with that then, off I went to start climbing these mountains. But initially, especially in the early 90s, the money that I got from one or two or three of my sponsors wasn't quite enough to climb professionally with full time. So I still had to do some guiding as well. And I worked for a few years with a friend of mine. This is Rob Hall from New Zealand. And he operated Adventure Consultants. And we partnered up, and one of the things we did first was we guided a group of clients to the summit of Everest. And this was in 1994. And I thought, okay, I'm still working as a guide, but I'm not able to go out and do my own things. I've always got these clients with me. How can I combine a paid, guided expedition with something that I kind of maybe want to do on my own? And I started to think, you know, when you go to Everest, you go all the way to Nepal, your expenses are paid, I'm getting a salary, I'm guiding a group of clients here for 8 or 10 weeks, I'm being acclimatized. And I thought, why not, while I'm already there in Nepal, why not just, instead of just doing one peak, why not do another one? Why not do two? And if you look at this picture of Mount Everest, right next to Mount Everest is a mountain called Lhotse. This is the fourth highest peak in the world. And the routes are quite similar. I thought, we'll climb Everest, we'll acclimatize, we'll come down, send our clients home, and then with my friend Rob, we'll just move that little red line over, and we'll climb back up, and we'll climb to the summit of Lhotse. So I called it a twofer, two for the price of one. You're already there. The beauty of it as well, being acclimatized, you don't have to spend the 6 or 7 or 8 weeks adjusting to the altitude. You can throw a pack on the bottom of the mountain, carry everything you need for 3 or 4 days, and then race to the top of one of these peaks. And rather than climbing it in 6 or 8 weeks, you do it in 3 days. The idea is you have everything with you, and as you're climbing then, you camp along the way. At the end of every day, you set up your tent, you climb inside, you spend the night, the next morning you pack it all up, and you move that camp with you. Very fast, very light, very efficient. And speed is safety. The faster you go in the mountains, the safer it is. On the final summit day, this is just 3 days after leaving base camp, you then race to the top. No oxygen, a water, all you carry is a water bottle, a camera, and maybe an energy bar. And you climb as fast as you can to the top. And boom, 3 days later, you're on the summit of an 8,000 meter peak. This is what we did in 1994. Here I'm getting just to the top of Lhotse, and this is just 7 days after standing on the summit of Mount Everest. So I thought this was a great idea. I could go to Nepal, warm up on Everest, and then quickly climb another mountain. So it's very economical. Getting paid to do one thing, and then quickly climbing another. So I did a lot of these twofers when I started to climb these 8,000 meter peaks. I then started to think about if I and how I wanted to organize my teams. And some of these clients, to be efficient and to be economical, I would sometimes climb with just one other partner. No Sherpa support, just two of us, less parts and pieces. And how did I decide how I wanted to pick those partners? My primary parameter was that I had to like my partner. Because if I didn't like him at sea level, I wasn't going to like him at 26,000 feet. So likability was huge on my list. Implicit trust. I needed to trust my partner. He needed to trust me. We're going to rope together. We're going to connect together on treacherous terrain. And if you don't trust your partner in those situations, there's no reason to connect. And the way we connect to these ropes, and I'll talk a little bit, for the engineering college sake, a little bit about the design and development of some of the gear that I got to help design and develop. To make things lighter, again, I talked about how you make things lighter, you have to make them smaller. This is one of the tents I helped design. And I'm standing there looking at it going, there's going to be two of us living in that little tiny tent. And somehow two of us climbing that with all of our gear. So comfort isn't really a requirement when you're climbing. It's about keeping things light, keeping them very, very simple and very, very basic. The way we connect ourselves to the mountain, to anchors and stuff like this, this is called a carabiner, or a metal clip link, you might say. Design and engineering has come into play when they develop these. This is you. You might have an anchor here on the rock, a piton or an ice screw into the ice, and then this gate here opens. You can open that and then run your rope through that. And for instance, this carabiner might weigh 1.5 ounces. To shave weight, they come out with a new way. This is a wire gate carabiner. The tensile strength, again, is going this way. And you can save about 20% of the weight of that carabiner just by using that wire gate instead of a piece of metal. And if you're carrying 10 or 15 or 20 of those parts of ounces add up. When you're connecting yourself with a carabiner that's going to be permanently attached to you with your harness to a rope, we use what's called a locking carabiner. As the gate is closed, this screwed barrel then would be rotated and twisted to permanently lock that gate closed. It's very heavy, but it's very bombproof, and so you don't really care about the weight. But that screwed-on barrel can freeze, you can get dirt in it, so it becomes harder sometimes to manipulate. And the latest piece of technology that was just developed, this is by Black Diamond, a hardware manufacturing company. They decided that rather than using this screw-type barrel gate, they put magnets in these two little lever arms. So from the bottom, you squeeze the levers, the magnets are separated, and then the gate is open. And there's a piece of metal here in this part where these two blue magnets then, when it's closed, clamp onto, and the gate is locked. And when the gate is open, these two magnets actually repel each other so that opening stays open because of the repelling nature of the magnets. So this is, design and engineering mostly for the hard goods. I'm more in the development of the soft goods, the tents and the clothing and that type of stuff. But it's all quite interesting, the development of what's going on in the climbing world. So even as I was then climbing, starting to climb these other 8,000 meter peaks, I kept going to Mount Everest as well. And in 1996, by then I'd been to Everest 7 times. And I was contemplating going for the 8th time. And I was wondering, how can we make this more interesting? I climbed it without oxygen, I guided it. I needed some intriguing reason to bring me back to Everest for the 8th time. And I got a really cool invitation. This is my friend David Brashears from Boston. Climbed Everest a couple of times. He was a high altitude filmmaker. And he said, Ed, I want you to come with me to Everest. And we're going to make this beautiful film about climbing to the top of the world. He was going to direct it. He would be the leader of the climb. And he had asked me to be the climbing leader. So my role would be the logistics and the day-to-day operation of the expedition. I would also then be in the film. I'd be a character in the film. And the objective then was to climb all the way to the top of Everest and film ourselves literally every step of the way and bring back a beautiful film that you guys could then watch in the comfort of the theater so you don't have to go to Everest yourselves. And this had been done before, you know, National Geographic, Discovery Channel. There's a lot of beautiful Everest films, but what nobody had attempted to try to do was to schlep a 40-pound IMAX camera to the top of Everest. And you know, to save weight on these mountains, we break our toothbrushes in half. And we're thinking of taking this 40-pound microwave-sized piece of metal to the top of Everest. To me, that was intriguing. And it was something that people were thinking would be literally impossible. And I think when people decide they don't want to do something, it's impossible. We thought it would barely be possible. And this is the reason I signed up, because it was going to be hard. And it was going to be interesting. And the vision that I have of what we're going to do is kind of something like this. So we knew we'd have to put together a really strong group of selfless individuals. People that were going to work together to help get this camera to the top of Everest. And so we were very careful about selecting the team. A huge part of our team, and very common to when you go to climb Everest, especially if you're doing a film or if you're guiding a group of people, and even since the Hillary era in 1953, is to hire the local Sherpa. This group of people that are born and raised at 12, 13, 14,000 feet in the higher areas of Nepal. Their physiology is well adapted to altitude, and through the years now, they become very confident mountaineers. So we hire a group of them, 10 or 12 or 15 of these guys, to help us carry all this gear up the mountain, day in and day out. You know, they're carrying 40, 50, 60 pounds of equipment. And rarely do they get the recognition that they deserve. These guys are workhorses. They're the unsung heroes of most successful Everest expedition. And they're just doing their job. You know, we pay them well, they get bonuses, they get the best gear, we feed them well. Without them, we wouldn't succeed. They're the backbone of our success. And it's more economical and way more efficient to get 12 of them to work with us than bringing, you know, 12 Westerners. And so it's very traditional that we hire Sherpa. So a year of planning and logistics went into this expedition. We then, in the spring of 1996, we travel to Kathmandu, Nepal. From there, we fly to another village at about 7,000 feet. And then from there, we spend the next 8 or 10 days walking to the base of the mountain. And behind us, we've got hundreds of porters and yaks that is bringing, you know, literally 5 tons of food and equipment behind us, which will then eventually be deposited here at base camp, 18,000 feet. And in 1996, when we arrived at base camp, it was like a literal international village of climbers. The floodgates of popularity on Everest had opened. There was well over 350 people here, 15 other expeditions. And we're all going to be trying to climb the mountain by the same route, the Hillary route. And if you've read Into Thin Air by John Krakauer, this was the year this all played out. My friend Rob Hall was guiding an expedition of clients. My friend Scott Fisher was guiding an expedition of clients. There was a whole bunch of people that we knew there. And we're all gonna hopefully try to climb the mountain by the same route. At each camp, we'll have our own tents and our own food and our own sleeping bags and our own oxygen, but we're gonna share the fixed ropes. We're gonna share the anchors. We're gonna help each other climb this mountain. Right out of the gates, from base camp here to camp one at 20,000 feet, it's one of the trickiest parts of the whole climb. You've got to climb through an area known as the Khumbu Icefall. The glacier's moving at about 4 feet per day, breaking up into these huge blocks of ice, some the size of this room, you know, towering above you, teetering, toppling, slowly shifting, slowly moving. And very unique to Everest, you engineering guys are going to love this, we bring these ladders with us, and we tie them together with ropes, and we construct these things that we climb up and over these blocks of ice. We build bridges to span these crevasses that might be 300 feet deep. And you know, the bigger the obstacle in the ice fall, the bigger the ladder. This is 9 ladders that we tie together to climb up and over this sheer ice face. And this place is very dynamic. It's unpredictable when that block of ice that we're climbing on could tumble and move. So you want to keep moving through here very, very quickly. You don't want to be sitting down there having lunch, you know, when that block of ice decides to fall. You climb out of that ice fall, takes anywhere from 3 to 7 hours, depending on how fast or how scared you are. And then you're still only at 20,000 feet. You've got 3 more camps to establish, 9,000 feet of climbing to go, and literally 6 or 8 weeks left to climb to the top of that mountain. So that's just the gateway to the upper part of the mountain. So we're doing what everybody else is doing, but we're also filming. We were the camera crew, we were the climbers, we were the load carriers. We had to do everything. Here's David filming within the ice fall. He's a perfectionist. He's a great director, but he's very anal about his directing. If he didn't like the way, for instance, Araceli climbed that ladder, when she got to the top, he would send her back down and have her climb the ladder again. Here's David filming at 25,000 feet. And imagine not only climbing Everest, but thinking about your shots and directing and then filming. This guy was amazing to work for. He was a great leader. He led from the front. He led by example. He wanted me to do something, I did it. About 6 weeks into this, we've got all our camps established. We're acclimatized. We're 2 days away. We're camp 3. We're 2 days away from the top of Everest and 2 days away from being done with this. But we were listening to the mountain. Even though we had a date on the calendar, for us it was May 9th, we were listening to what the mountain was telling us. And it was still windy, and it was still cold, and the weather was not the calm period that we were waiting for. So rather than being fixated with that date on the calendar, we decided to go down and wait for conditions to improve. And as we went down, the other teams went up. Rob Hall, Scott Fisher, Taiwanese. Literally 40 people, 3 expeditions joined forces to go to the top, and their selected summit day was May 10th. Here's that final stretch of the climb. This is Camp 4 at 26,000 feet, and then from there you've got 3,000 feet of climbing to go to the top. About 12 hours. So if you leave at 2 in the morning, at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, you better be on the summit, because that is the amount of oxygen that you have. 18-hour round trip based on the amount of oxygen that you're carrying. If you climb longer than 12 hours to get to the top, you're going to start using the oxygen that you need for the descent. That was one of the great errors that happened that day. They climbed far too long into the day. This is a photo that Scott Fisher took on his way to the summit at about 28,700 feet. This short section of climb here, about 40 feet, is known as the Hillary Step. It's very steep, almost vertical. One at a time, you can only go up that. And here's basically what you call a conga line of climbers waiting in line to go up that section of climb. It's like waiting at Starbucks for a cup of coffee. This has very rarely happened until this day. This slowed things up. There was a lot of things that went wrong that day, a lot of decisions, not one decision, not one person, a multitude of things that slowed things down, and then the straw that broke the camel's back was this huge storm that blew in late in the day. In the end, 8 people died high in the mountain during that storm. We were lower on the mountain. We put our own ambitions aside, we put our camera down, we gave away supplies of oxygen, and we as a team climbed up in an effort to help bring down survivors from that tragic event. And we did manage to bring down a number of people. But as I said, sadly, 8 people died. 2 of them were my great friends, Rob Hall and Scott Fisher, died high in the mountain. And the sad reality was that if you can't climb up to them fast enough, they'll die of exposure and hypoxia. You can't fly helicopters that high to initiate rescues. So we literally evacuated the mountain had a memorial service for those that died, and most other teams at that point, they packed up and went home. You can imagine why. This is a sad event. David left it up to us, the production company left it up to us as to what we wanted to do. I had already decided I wanted to go back up. I wanted to turn that season into something more positive. And I felt that, you know, we as a team, we hadn't done anything wrong. Why should we quit? Why should we give up? And I kind of wanted to show the world as well that you could climb Everest and live to talk about it. You just had to be more patient and wait for the right conditions. And 2 weeks later, we got the right conditions. Here we are making those final steps to the summit of Everest. It was a glorious, spectacular day. And this is an actual piece of footage that David shot with the IMAX camera. This Araceli and John Lang are now short of the summit. Beautiful day. And this IMAX film that was released a year later, titled Everest, became the largest grossing IMAX film in history. So I think we were rewarded not only for what we did during the rescues, but for our patience as well. And I got to the summit, it was my fourth time, my third time again without supplemental oxygen, and I thought that was great. But the cool part of that climb was when we finally saw the damn camera on the summit. You know, that was one of the hardest things I've ever been involved with. And in spite of all the obstacles, in spite of all the difficulties, you know, we kind of went around them, we persevered as a team, and we got the camera to the summit of Everest. And having it standing there on the tripod, it's all we could do to keep ourselves from pushing it over the edge, you know, to get rid of it. But to me, that was an amazing event. You know, a roller coaster of emotions. People died, they were friends of mine. We had a hard climb, we succeeded. You know, how do you feel when you come home from something like that? And it was worldwide news. And so people, when I got home, you know, they questioned, why would I still want to climb mountains where people are dying left and right? And I didn't feel that I was immune to the danger. You know, I thought that, you know, that something could happen, but I felt that I was somehow managing the risk differently, maybe training harder, maybe I was more conservative. For whatever reason, I felt that I wanted to keep going out there to finish my project. I still had about 7 or 8 peaks to go, and so I didn't want to quit. And so I went out and I kept climbing, and I got to still go halfway around the world multiple times. And got to go climb peaks like Manaslu and Dalagiri in Nepal, and peaks like Shishapangma in Tibet, and Nanga Parbat in Pakistan. And all told, to climb the 14 peaks, I went on 21 Himalayan expeditions. So if you do the math, that's 2 out of 3. And yes, for every 2 out of 3 climbs, everything that could go right went right, nothing went wrong, and boom, we'd get to the top. I'd come home, no frostbite, I'd have all my fingers and toes, I never lost a partner, never had an accident. And when I went on those climbs and came home like that, you know, the media, they were pretty disinterested because nothing happened. They're like, Ed, you know, nobody died. And I go, that's the way it should be. This is the way I want it to be. You know, don't get used to that other way, because I felt for me, this is the way it should be. And on a third of these climbs, you know, we go halfway around the world, spend weeks and weeks trying to climb one of these mountains, sometimes be shut down 40 feet from the summit. But I was willing to walk away in the face of high, uncontrollable risk. I said, you know what, it's not going to happen today. I'll come back next year. Big deal. It's better to be alive. So I had for myself this, what I call, level of personal acceptable risk. Things that I would do and things that I wouldn't do. And I tried to surround myself with partners that thought the same way. And that's how I think I stayed alive in climbing these mountains. So eventually, about 17 years into this project, I climbed 13 of these 14 mountains. And the one mountain that in the end was my nemesis, the hardest climb of my life, was Annapurna. This happens to be the most dangerous 8,000 meter peak in the world. Barely 100 people had climbed to the top, and 50 people had died trying. Not great odds. And I went there twice. I went there in 2000, and I went there again in 2002, and both times walked away. This is one nasty mountain. Based on its architecture, It's got avalanches that protect all of its faces. And so when you're climbing underneath that stuff, it's like playing Russian roulette. And after walking away twice and seeing how dangerous this mountain was, I thought to myself, you know what? It's not going to be smart killing yourself on that 14th peak. And I thought, you know, based on the risk, I should probably not attempt to try to climb Annapurna. Be happy with 13 out of 14. And I kind of convinced myself that that was a pretty good track record. But I'm pretty stubborn, I'm pretty motivated, I get pretty fixated. And so I thought, I've got to go back one more time, at least to sit at the bottom of that mountain and let it decide so I'm face to face with it. And I decided in the spring of 2005 to go back to Annapurna for the third time and hopefully have good conditions. And I don't make these decisions lightly. You know, I'm married now, I've been married for 15 years. My wife met me as a climber. She knew what I was doing when we met. And she's believed in me every step of the way. She's never told me to quit. She's always trusted my judgment. And when I said I'm going back to Annapurna for that third time, she said, go and do it. She believed in my judgment and allowed me to do that. And that helped me a lot. Imagine that. So my partner and I, we go to Annapurna, and we're already acclimatized, hoping that if conditions allowed, we would race to the summit in just 3 days. And we sat at the base of Annapurna for a week, letting it tell us what to do. And in 2005, conditions were absolutely phenomenal. It wasn't a single avalanche, it was colder, it seemed like the mountain was stuck together better than I'd ever seen it. And so off we went. We're gonna carry all our stuff with us again, and hopefully in 3 days of climbing, we'll be on the summit. And here we are climbing right up the North Face. We've got big towering blocks of ice over us. Nothing fell. We had steep terrain to climb. We didn't fall. And I thought with every step that we took, somebody or something was kind of watching over us, maybe safeguarding us. Or maybe it had to do with Karma National Bank. And all the rescues and good stuff I'd done in my life, I put deposits into the Karma National Bank. Now I was slowly taking something out. 3 days of climbing then brought us toward the summit. And on May 12, 2005, then I finally sat on the summit of Annapurna, ending an 18-year project to climb all 14 8,000-meter peaks. It was literally that dream come true moment. You know, imagine this place that you kind of dreamt about and visualized and thought you might never ever get to. And when you're finally there, it is literally a dream come true. For me, it was one of the highlights of my life. You know, this was a personal goal, and I completed this personal goal. And 24 hours later, we're off on the bottom of Annapurna. And I kind of look back on that. I go, that was one of the toughest challenges of my life. I would have wanted to get rid of Annapurna earlier in my career. But appropriately, it was the last 8,000-er. And I think for good reason. I mean, I needed 30 years of experience to do that mountain the right way and to survive it. So thankfully, it was at the end of the list. And somehow, poetically, you know, this book that I read as a kid in Illinois put me on that path to climbing Annapurna. So my goal, my journey had come full circle. So in closing now, and if you ever get the chance to read this book, it's an amazing story. Maurice Herzog, who dictated this book then, the last sentence of the book, I'll always remember it, and I'll paraphrase, he basically says that we all have our own Annapurnas. And I think that's a great metaphor for life. You know, if you look on the horizon of your life, you're literally climbing mountain after mountain after mountain. And I think these mountains that we have, these goals, these challenges that we have in our lives, they're there for a reason. They allow us to test ourselves, to see what we're capable of doing, to see how hard we can push ourselves, you know, as individuals. You know, when I'm climbing mountains, I have to be personally motivated. I've got to do my homework and train. And I've got to go there for the right reasons, you know, to challenge myself. So I've got to personally put in a lot of time and energy and effort. And that's true with any goal that we have. But to succeed in those goals, we've got to surround ourselves with good people. You know, at work, you've got coworkers, you've got partners, you've got friends, you've got family. They all support you when you're climbing those mountains. And they might help you physically, they might help you emotionally, they might help you psychologically. And that's how I succeeded in climbing these mountains, with the help of a lot of people. And also, I think the key ingredient to success in whatever you do is passion. If you love what you do, it doesn't matter how long it takes, because you enjoy the journey and you enjoy the process. So I always tell young people that whatever path you choose in your life, you know, do it for reasons that keep you happy and things that you know you can do for many, many years to come. And that means being passionate about what you do. And if you do that, you'll succeed no matter what you try. Thank you. Questions at all? Yes?
So what's next?
I'll repeat the question, Sisu. You know, now I'm doing a lot of climbs that I didn't get to do when I was busy doing this. And actually, in 2009, I went back to Everest again for the 11th time. I went to Antarctica last year, about a year ago, and climbed the highest peak down there called Vincent Massif. I went back to Mount McKinley this spring. So I'm kind of getting to pick and choose. And I doubt that I'll go to any other 8,000 meter peak again, but maybe Everest, stuff like that. Yes? Yes. Yeah. Oh, that's a good question. I mean, I'll answer the second part first, I guess. You know, putting your name on a product, you know, this is, the outdoor industry is fairly big, but it's not gigantic. And I do have a few products out there with my initials on them and stuff. And I do get a few residual payments, but to start my own actual company, it's very hard. There's so many companies out there doing what they're doing, and they're doing okay, but it's easier for me to work with companies. Right now I'm working with First Ascent at Eddie Bauer, and I am on the design team, and it's pretty cool because they allow us to design the products that they then build and sell. And because of that, we get a retainer. So I kind of get paid to do that, but I don't actually own my own manufacturing or retail business. So I do have a little bit of hand of it. As far as the cleanup goes, yes, there's a lot of tourists that go in and out. There's a lot of climbers that are on the mountain. But for the last 10 or 15 years now, that garbage problem has been reversed. You know, there is a huge effort to make sure that whatever people bring in, they bring out, and the culture has changed. Even on Everest, you know, for many, many years, since the 50s, people left their empty oxygen bottles on the mountain. And then at the highest camp, at 26,000 feet, there was literally 1,000 or 2,000 bottles just laying there. It was like a sea of oxygen bottles. Something that we started kind of in the early 90s, Rob Hall, Scott Fisher, some others. We would go to Everest with some extra cash in hand from sponsors. And we would use that. When the Sherpas then carried loads to one of the higher camps, you know, they typically would come down with empty packs. And we said, we'll give you $10 per bottle that you bring down. So we put a value on that garbage. And man, those bottles, they flew down the hill. And I was there just, you know, in 2009 at the high camp, you couldn't find an oxygen bottle. So the cleanup process has been well underway, and the mountain is cleaner than I've ever seen it.
Thank you. Yeah. So apart from passion, what do you think is a key ingredient to surmounting such challenges?
To climbing to the top?
I mean, that's what you've been exposed to, yeah. I mean, tough challenges.
Well, I mean, like I said, you've got to learn what you do. And it's climbing without oxygen is one of the physically hardest things I can imagine, mentally as well. But because I was personally motivated, I enjoyed the process, and I knew that whatever I put into it, no matter how hard it was, it would be satisfying and rewarding. And that's what it was to me. You know, all that effort, all that planning, all that energy, you don't realize it along the way, but when you finally then get to the top and you do succeed, that's a great feeling. And then you look back, and you forget all the bad parts, and you remember only the good stuff. And that's what drove me back time and time again. I think physically, the way I was able to climb without oxygen was that I trained ferociously. About halfway through my career, they actually put me into a laboratory, and they analyzed my physiology, and they discovered that I have a high VO2 max, meaning that I can take in and utilize oxygen very efficiently. I have larger than normal lungs. I have a smaller than normal brain, you know.